Hey, hi everybody. My name is Sarah Zahab. I'm a registered kinesiologist, exercise physiologist, and I've been working full-time in the fitness industry for the last 15 years. Really excited to be here for our webinar, Prenatal Exercise, Strength, Cardio, and Beyond. I think it's amazing that we can all sort of come together from the comfort of our own homes, and I want to thank Camp It Pro for allowing us to do this. So, just as a side note before we get started, we're going to leave questions until the very end, so hang on. Oftentimes we learn some wonderful things from questions, so I'm just going to encourage you to sort of hang on to your questions, maybe jot them down until the very end where I'll be going through them. And if I happen to miss any of the questions, I will be getting a recording or a list of the questions that I might have missed, so I'll be sure to email you with an answer if I haven't gotten to you. So, we're going to get going, and we're going to start off with just a quick overview of what we're going to be covering off together in the next hour. We're going to be covering off very briefly some of the benefits of prenatal exercise. Not going to spend too much time on this. I know you guys are with me on the benefits here. We're going to go into detail with the specific Canadian guidelines for exercise during pregnancy, just listing those off, and I'm going to be sharing some very interesting articles with regards to the latest research in terms of pregnancy and exercise. I'm going to be giving you some very specific things to focus on with your clients and group fitness participants in terms of the areas of focus during pregnancy, so how you're to design your programs and what sort of exercises, specific exercises are going to be best suited for them. I'll be giving you a very specific exercise prescription, and I do have some videos that I'll be showing you if you're not certain of the exercises, so we'll be going through some video as well. And at the very end, as I mentioned, we're going to be going through some questions. So oftentimes I get some amazing questions, and it's really great to be able to sort of learn from everybody. And hang on also, because at the end of that, Jason's going to come on from Camp It Pro, and he's going to be just sort of outlining how to obtain some of the CECs. All right, so let's get going. We're going to start off with just a very general overview of the benefits of prenatal exercise, and I'm not really going to sort of read them out one by one. You guys can sort of take a peek, but it's very interesting. You know, many years ago when we first kind of started, you know, exercise wasn't really something that was prescribed during pregnancy, and over the years this has evolved, and we're really able to see that there are a lot of benefits to exercise during pregnancy, and especially in the last 5 or so years, I'm really seeing a lot of articles and studies in mainstream media, like the Globe and Mail and the New York Times and Canada.com and all these amazing resources that are saying, these articles in these places that are saying, yes, exercise is extremely beneficial during pregnancy. Women shouldn't shy away from exercise during pregnancy and uncomplicated pregnancies. And so this is where we play a really key role in helping our clients and group fitness participants and helping them to get into their healthiest and fittest state and maintaining that throughout their pregnancies. So pretty excited to see a lot of those benefits being touted in mainstream media. With specific with the Canadian guidelines, essentially the CSEP, which is the Canadian Society for Exercise Physiology, in conjunction with the Society for the Obstetricians and Gynecologists of Canada, have created very specific guidelines when it comes to exercise and pregnancy. And essentially they're saying in uncomplicated pregnancies, women with or without a sedentary lifestyle should be encouraged to participate in aerobic and strength conditioning exercises as part of a healthy lifestyle. And now this is really exciting specifically for me, because they not only say that cardiovascular exercise is key, but that strength conditioning exercises are an essential part of a healthy lifestyle in pregnancy. And the American guidelines don't really delve into the strength portion. They really just say that people should be doing cardiovascular activity, and the strength training is kind of secondary. They say that if you've been doing it before pregnancy, you can continue on during your pregnancy. The Canadian guidelines are really that much more advanced to say that, yeah, strength training is important, and a lot of the benefits that I've sort of touted on that previous page are obtained through effective, safe, and proper strength training exercises. So the things like improved posture and the reduction of low back pain and discomfort and the prevention of diastasis recti and being able to have that healthy connective tissue and joint stability. You're going to hear me say a lot of that, talking about stability during pregnancy, is sort of achieved through strength training. So really excited to be seeing this. And essentially, the recommendations say that if you're sedentary, start off 15 minutes three times a week and gradually move up to 30 minutes 4 days a week. And they're also saying that you want to select activities that minimize the loss of balance or fetal trauma. And they go on to give specific examples. Loss of balance activities would be things like downhill skiing or horseback riding. Things that would cause fetal trauma would be like rocket sports where a ball would come and potentially hit the fetus. Now, I don't know if you guys remember a couple of years ago where there was a woman who ran the Toronto Marathon 39 weeks pregnant. She did have her her doctor's approval to run half and walk half. And you're going to be seeing and hearing a lot of women saying, I can do this and I've done this. And if they have their caregiver's approval, their doctor's approval, that's awesome. But as a fitness professional, we need to sort of follow these guidelines. And when that was sort of happening with the woman running the marathon at 39 and a half weeks pregnant, I was on CBC Radio doing a call-in show with Ontario Today. And essentially, the topic was, what do you think of this? Is this, safe or unsafe? Or what would you recommend? And as a fitness professional, it's not something that I can recommend. It's really sort of beyond my scope. But it was amazing to see a lot of people calling in saying, I rode my bike throughout my pregnancy. I went horseback riding all the way through my pregnancy. I did these, things that are considered contraindicative throughout their pregnancy. And, I think that's great that people do that. And most times, probably, they're going to have a very healthy pregnancy and have no contraindications or complications and have healthy babies. But as fitness professionals, we need to sort of be safe and effective and not recommend these types of activities. If you guys have any specific questions about that, you can let me know at the end of the webinar. We also want to avoid supine or prone movements after week 16 weeks gestation. So after 16 weeks, roughly around there, you don't want to be doing activities where you're lying flat on your stomach. Obviously, you don't want to compress the placenta and the fetus. You also don't want to be doing any exercises where you're lying flat on your back. And the reason is, I'm sure many of you have heard this, but lying on your back, flat on your back, at around 16 weeks and beyond is that point where we could be putting some pressure on the inferior vena cava, which is a vein, and that can cut off blood flow to the placenta. Now, it very rarely happens, and I've heard some doctors saying, well, it's not really an issue, but and in some cases, they're saying no extended periods of being lying supine. But again, as fitness professionals, as a general rule, nothing lying flat on the back. And typically, you would see signs of dizziness or feelings of unwell, nausea, but we would just sort of avoid bench press and core exercises where you're lying flat on your back are not to be done after 16 weeks. And absolute indications to stop exercise, things like excessive shortness of breath, chest pain, painful uterine contractions, any sort of loss of fluid, vaginal bleeding is something to look for, and presyncope. And presyncope is basically that feeling faint, dizziness. So those are absolute indications to stop exercise. Pretty straightforward. So I've got some pretty interesting articles to share with you, some studies. The first was done by Linda May that I came across a couple of years ago, and she's an amazing doctor who has done a lot of research, a lot of cool research in the area of prenatal and postnatal exercise. And she found that babies born to exercising mothers had healthier hearts at birth and 30 days into their new lives. And this just blew me away because we know that exercise during pregnancy can directly affect mom's cardiovascular health and her physical well-being, but we now know that moms who exercise can directly affect the cardiovascular health of their unborn babies. And they looked at things like beat-to-beat variability and heart rate recovery and the robustness of heart rate. And they found that this finding was actually more robust or greater in the babies of moms who exercised more. So you'll see this effect. I think it was something like 3 days a week. And the moms who exercise more than that have babies with even healthier hearts. And this just sort of blew me away. These are the things that we as fitness professionals get a little excited about, or at least I do. So that was a really cool study and great to sort of share with your clients or participants and sort of say, yeah, you know, when the motivation is feeling low, when they're feeling really icky, the nausea and discomfort is kicking in, it can really sort of, you know, encourage them to say that, you know, it's going to help you, but it's also going to help baby in terms of giving them the best start in life and helping them with their cardiovascular health, which is always key. The next article that I wanted to share with you was by Schoenfeld. He's done a lot of analysis of various studies, and he has found that strength training until delivery is safe, and that there are no real contraindications to strength training throughout pregnancy. So this is kind of cool because, you know, we've heard in, you know, recommending prenatal yoga, and yes, do the cardio and walk, and you know, maybe do some aerobic exercise and some aqua fitness. But we can really sort of say with confidence that yeah, proper and effective and safe strength training program will really be beneficial, and there's no contraindications. Now that doesn't apply to CrossFit, so safe and effective. And another interesting article I came across, the British Journal of Sports Medicine, last year, a year and a half ago, found that exercise during pregnancy reduces the incidence of big baby syndrome. And big baby syndrome is essentially giving birth to a baby that is over 4 kilos or 8.8 pounds. So a baby that's born this weight or greater is considered to have big baby syndrome. And so moms who exercise are less likely to have a larger baby, which means, you know, the reduced likelihood of a C-section or forceps intervention or complications with delivery. So, and if there are any of you moms out there who have had a baby with big baby syndrome, you're probably sort of nodding your heads like, yeah, this is, you know, it's great to be able to prevent that. All right, so we've gone through some research and so in terms of areas that you wanted to focus on, in our strength training exercises, the areas that you're going to focus on specifically, and these are the areas that mom is going to get or new mom is going to get the most benefit out of her program are the TVAs or the transverse abdominis. And this muscle is one of the most deep layers of the abdominal musculature that really helps to provide that spinal stabilization, the stabilization of the torso and the pelvis, the muscle that's really going to help with taking the pressure off of the lumbar spine and being able to support not only mom's neutral spine, but the growing uterus, the baby, and her postural shift. So, you know, we all sort of understand the importance of training the core and the deep core, and I'm going to be going into a lot of detail with regards to core training during pregnancy. So that's an area that we want to focus on. We also want to focus on the scapular stabilizers. And these are the muscles that are in and around the shoulder blades, the low traps, the mid traps, the rhomboids. As the pregnancy progresses, we know that a lot of weight gets put into the breast. The shoulders tend to round forward, so we get this excessive thoracic curvature in addition to a lumbar lordosis or a sway back position. And so our center of gravity is kind of shifting forward and outward, and the posture is kind of shifting. It's very difficult. Are much more difficult to maintain that neutral position with the scapular stabilizers. So we want to be able to, you know, ensure that the chest is nice and open and we're able to have the ability to depress the shoulder blades, maintain that scapular depression. When the low traps and mid traps are weak, we tend to compensate with the upper trap musculature, and this is something that we see in the general population as well. The technology and our work environments and our day-to-day activities aren't really helping, you know, with smartphones and computers and driving and sort of collapsing at the end of the day and contorting ourselves into these funny positions. So being able to focus on those posterior chain muscles, the mid-back muscles, to help with maintaining that neutral spine and realigning the posture. We know that when our body is properly aligned, there's the least amount of pressure on our joints. And we know that when baby comes, mom is going to be spending a lot of time in this forward round of position, feeding, nursing. She's not going to be focusing on her posture too much then. So everything we can do beforehand to strengthen and stabilize is going to be really key. So the scapular stabilizers are a great area to focus on during pregnancy. And then we have the gluteus medius, the glute med, which we call for short, or the hip stabilizers. And we know that the glute med is an area that, in terms of the people that we've seen when we do our musculoskeletal assessment, the glute med is weak in many people. And you can tell when people are walking, or we see this a lot in runners, when they're running, they're sort of sinking in the hips, and they've got a lot of instability in the hip area. And so during pregnancy, we have the two pubic bones in the front of the body, so in the front, it's the two pubic bones, the hip bones that are sort of connected. They're connected by this cartilaginous joint called the pubic symphysis. And that sort of connects the two pubic bones together. Now, normal individuals, there's a little bit of wiggle room. There's a little bit of give in this joint. However, during pregnancy, because there is a lot of relaxant that's being released in the bloodstream, which makes our ligaments lax or loose, this pubic symphysis joint kind of opens up a little more. There's a little more give to allow, prepare the body for labor and delivery and allow space for birth, for childbirth. So we want to have a little more hip stabilization, especially if the center of gravity starts to shift, the body becomes a little more lordotic. We tend to see a bit more of an anterior pelvic tilt where the pelvis kind of shifts forward during pregnancy. So those hip stabilizers are going to be a really key area to focus on. And I have videos for all of these areas that I'm sort of talking about here. Then we have the posture, which of course we want to be able to maintain throughout the pregnancy or as best as we can. And then the pelvic floor, I'm sure you're all sort of smiling and laughing at this point. We know that new moms and our prenatal clients and group fitness participants need to Kegel. And there are some fitness, some health professionals that say we need to Kegel every day until we die. Not only for bladder control and core control, but in terms of supporting the uterus during pregnancy specifically. So we'll be going through some very specific pelvic floor exercises. Okay. So in terms of some general things to think about during your program design, you'll want to avoid all prone and supine movements after week 16, like I sort of mentioned before. This next one's a biggie. You definitely want to avoid all rectus abdominis or oblique work to avoid diastasis recti. And this is something that I'm going to be going through in subsequent slides. But for those of you who are currently providing crunches or doing any type of twisting, crunching motions, those are specific exercises that you will definitely want to stop throughout pregnancy and in the postnatal period. So hang on to that. I'm going to come back to that in a little minute on the next slide. You'll also want to avoid overstretching and specifically strengthening the adductors. There's a group of 8 adductor muscles. Those are your inner thigh muscles. Many of those adductor muscles come in and attach into that pubic symphysis area, into that pubic symphysis joint, the joint that attaches the two hip bones together. So when you sort of do those isolating, specific, targeted exercises to the adductors, because of their attachments in and around the pubic symphysis, this pubic symphysis is not as stable as we would be outside of pregnancy. So really key to avoid targeting that area, to avoid any pubic symphysis dysfunction, to avoid any tears or pulling in this area. So I don't know that anyone really does this anymore, but those machines where you kind of, I don't even know what they're called, where you kind of squeeze in together, you guys know what I'm talking about, right? You know, you sit back and kind of set a weight, and that is an absolute contraindication that you don't want to be doing that during pregnancy because it can cause some pubic symphysis dysfunction. With the pubic symphysis dysfunction, with the diastasis recti, because we're dealing with ligaments and tissue, not just muscles, it's a long recovery. So the more we can do in terms of prevention, much better mom will be sort of in terms of her recovery and bouncing back after baby. The other thing that we want to pay attention to is proper technique when rising from supine. So essentially when your prenatal client is lying on your back or on her side when she's coming out of bed or coming up from a lying down position, it's important to roll over onto the side and push up with the hands. So we definitely don't want to be doing a crunching pattern to come straight up from a lying down position. I know of a lot of new moms who have gotten diastasis just from getting up improperly. So really key to be able to sort of roll over to the side every time you get up and push up with the hands. All right, so I think most of you probably already know that one in terms of the importance of getting up properly. The other thing that you'll want to avoid is that Valsalva's maneuver, which is essentially closing off the breath, so holding the breath, and increasing that intra-abdominal pressure. So you don't want to be encouraging moms to hold their breath. You want to encourage them to breathe throughout their exercises and, you know, encouraging them to not sort of create that intra-abdominal pressure. All right, so now on to the hot topic that everyone usually has a lot of questions about, diastasis. I'm going to be spending a little bit of time on this. Diastasis is essentially a separation of the rectus abdominis at the linea alba. So the rectus abdominis is directly connected to the linea alba, which actually during pregnancy is called the linea nigra. It turns dark. And the rectus abdominis, this is the most superficial abdominal musculature, is attached at that point. Now, pregnancy doesn't really cause diastasis, but poor posture during pregnancy and our movement during pregnancy can cause diastasis. We see it in obese individuals. We see it in other individuals. There are some genetic predispositions to diastasis, and women with multiples, you know, with twins or triplets, and women who have had more, like, subsequent pregnancies, they're more common to get it second, third, fourth time, or, well, fourth. I don't know if anyone has had four. Yes, if you have had four. So it's really, it's our movement. And so really ensuring that you're not putting pressure on the linea alba. The linea alba is basically that straight line, and the connective tissue is weakest at the navel. If you look at the picture here, on the left-hand side, you see a normal rectus abdominis attached very beautifully to the linea alba. On the right-hand side, you see what a diastasis looks like. Essentially, the two sides of the rectus abdominis are split from the linea alba. You have this hole, and it's essentially this thin connective tissue, kind of like saran wrap, that ends up supporting the abdominal wall where the rectus abdominis is split. So you end up with a lot of dysfunction in through the abdominal wall. The abdominal wall is not being held tightly. We have this opening with this thin connective tissue supporting our organs and supporting our spine. And so we get the internal organs that get kind of pushed out, all right? And a sure way, if you're not sure sort of how to test it, I'm going to show you how to test for diastasis. But if you're not sure, listening to a pregnant mom or a new mom say, oh, I used to have an innie belly button before my pregnancy, and now I have an outie. An outie belly button is an indication of a diastasis. When a pregnant woman is coming up into a crunch, if you see a cone-like shape or kind of bulge, I will be showing you a picture of that later on as well. That's an indication of a diastasis. The rectus abdominis has split, so when you curl up and strain the rectus, you get this sort of cone shape or bulge. And then postnatally, oftentimes new moms who have a diastasis will say, you know, I'm gotten back to my shape everywhere else, but I still look like I'm 4 months pregnant. That's another indication. Some people call it mummy tummy, that she does have a diastasis. Oftentimes during pregnancy, you know, the rectus abdominis is meant to sort of stretch out and allow space for growing baby, and then normally comes right back into its position afterwards. However, crunching type movements, so any time where you're putting that forceful pressure on the rectus abdominis, that can cause the diastasis. Okay, so we want to avoid all types of crunching movements because that puts that strain on the rectus abdominis and can cause that pulling. The rectus abdominis is already being put on stretch. And trust me, the rectus abdominis, you're not going to get focused on a six-pack during pregnancy. You definitely want to be focusing on the deeper abdominal musculature, like the transverse abdominis, that's going to be able to support mom, support the uterus, and support the growing baby. And so, in actuality, I personally haven't done any crunches in 6 years, and many of my clients, I would say like 99% of them, don't actually crunch We do have a handful of Olympic-level sort of paddlers, or depending on their sport, they may do some crunching type activities if that's sort of the sport specificity. But for the general population, there are hundreds of other more effective exercises to target the core and train the core, and I'll be sharing a few with you here. So hang on, and we'll get to those at the end. Also, so we have the rectus abdominis, which is that top layer of the abdominal musculature. Beneath, we have the external obliques. Under that, we have the internal obliques. And then beneath that, we have the transverse abdominis. And so the rectus abdominis has this sheath called an aponeurosis, and it's sort of like a sheath that covers the rectus abdominis. We have the external obliques that sort of come into this sheath. So the external obliques sort of insert at the lower three ribs and come into the sheath and come into the linea alba. The internal obliques insert at the SIS and the pubic bones and sort of come upwards into the linea alba, into the sheath. Same thing with the transverse abdominis. There are multiple sort of insertion and attachment points. They're different below the navel and above the navel. But because of these attachment points, when you're training the transverse abdominis and the internal external obliques in a stabilizing manner, you are in essence training the rectus abdominis because of its attachment points into the aponeurosis of the rectus abdominis. I don't know if I've lost you there, but I'll give you, this is a great textbook by Sherman, who's a physiotherapist, and she did a study and found that in a push-up, the external obliques were more engaged than in a twisting type of crunching exercise. So when we compare the twisting crunch, when she had the electrodes and found which exercises provided the most activation or engagement, the push-up engaged and activated the external obliques more than a twisting crunch would. All right, so these twisting crunching type exercises not only are going to put strain on the linea alba and potentially cause a diastasis or make a diastasis worse if she does have a diastasis, but they're just not necessary at this point in the pregnancy and definitely in the immediate postpartum period. Now, during pregnancy, we cannot correct the diastasis. We can only prevent it from getting worse. So in this lecture, we're just going to be talking about preventative strategies. And in my other workshop, the postnatal exercise workshop on April 17th, I'm going to be covering off more specific strategies to help with correction and adjustments. All right, so I'm sure we'll have hold on to your questions, maybe make a note of them so we can get to them at the end. But essentially, the integrity and the functional strength of the abdominal wall is reduced, and we typically see things like low back pain, pelvic instability, pelvic floor dysfunction. Low back pain is a big one. So when the diastasis occurs, typically the transverse abdominis is not weak. It's not sort of holding everything in properly. There's a lot of instability that happens, especially at the joint of L5, S1. There's a lot of unwanted movement, and this can cause a lot of strain in the lumbar spine. All right, so focusing on the deep core, the transverse abdominis can be very helpful. Now, if you're unsure about diastasis, you can perform a check. And if you guys want to pop down on the floor and give this a try while I kind of talk you through it, you can do that, or try it at a later time. As someone who sort of felt thousands of women, it just takes kind of practice. So you have to sort of practice on yourself and on your friends and on as many people as possible to sort of get a feel for what a diastasis feels like. Essentially, you're going to lay on your back. With your knees bent, you can see in the picture that the feet are flat. And you're going to place your fingers not vertically but horizontally, sort of sideways, like a cross section in the belly button. Now, the rectus abdominis of the linea alba, healthy, should feel like your finger right between a knuckle. All right, so if you put your finger in there, it should feel like there's just a small gap between the two knuckles. So this would be the rectus abdominis if we're sort of looking. And then you're going to raise the head slowly and feel for the two sides of the rectus abdominis to feel like a hugging. And if you can fit more than two fingers, so technically diastasis is 2.5 fingers or more separation, then that's considered a diastasis. So you'll want to check it at the navel. That's typically the weakest connective tissue. You'll also want to check with the the linea alba runs right from the sternum rib cage down to the pubic bone. So you'll want to check above the navel and below the navel. So with all of my clients, I will check at the navel, above, and below. You will also record the depth. So usually it's in terms of shallow, medium, or deep. And you know, you can sort of feel, the more people you sort of play around with and test, you'll be able to feel the difference between a shallow groove and a deep groove. And a deep groove is kind of like, whoa, there's no end to it. It just, you can really get your fingers deep into the linea alba. A deep groove, typically, sometimes you can actually feel the pulse, a pulse through the connective tissue. That's an indication of a weakened connective tissue in a deep groove. So, you know, I'm almost more concerned with someone who has a diastasis that's 2.5 fingers but a deep groove than someone who has like a 3 or 3.5 finger diastasis but a shallow groove. Because in terms of correction, the first thing that needs to happen is the connective tissue needs to build up first before the two sides of the rectus abdominis can come back together. So the health of the connective tissue is very, very key in pregnancy. And so keeping those deep core muscles small, strong, and avoiding the movement that puts strain on the connective tissue, the already stretched connective tissue, like the crunches, like the twisting, like getting up improperly, ensuring that you're rolling over to the side. Those are things that are going to be really key in terms of diastasis prevention. Okay, so I've covered off at the navel, above, below. The RA and the LA stand for you're feeling for both sides of the rectus abdominis at the linea alba. So you're measuring the depth and the width, recording it. You don't want to be checking your diastasis too often because essentially a diastasis check is straining the rectus abdominis. So you're essentially crunching, which is putting a little bit of pressure. So we just use that position to check, to perform a diastasis check. I know some physiotherapists that actually do a check at rest and then a crunch, and they record the numbers, and sometimes it's usually bigger at rest. And so they'll do their sort of check, kind of digging their fingers in, and then perform the crunch. So you can play around with what works best for you. I find it easier to crunch. It's easier to feel the two sides of the rectus abdominis. However, I usually typically only do a diastasis check every 4 to 6 weeks. Not much is going to change in terms, well, when we get to correction, it takes a long time. But you don't want to be doing this too often because you're essentially straining the rectus abdominis and putting that pressure on the umbilicus. Okay. So the one thing that we're looking at, remember what I was talking about when you're doing the crunches, that sort of bulging position, that football shape, that cone shape? This is definitely what it looks like. And you can see the navel is sort of protruding out. That's a definite diastasis that she's got there. You also want to watch, I'm sorry to have you on this picture for a while here while I talk. I know it's not the nicest picture to look at. But you also want to watch for when you're doing things like push-up and plank and those front-loaded activities, if you are seeing this bulge, if mom is not able to kind of use her transverse and draw the navel inwards and upwards and take the pressure off the umbilicus, then you will want to omit push-ups, planks, those types of exercises, you know, jackknifes and mountain climbers, those types of activities. If new mom, especially in the latter stages of pregnancy, cannot hold and support her abdomen and her torso and pelvis in a neutral position, then you would definitely want to omit these exercises. So this is what you're looking for, that bulge when they're in those front-loaded activities. And you might have to get under there and kind of take a peek and see, especially if the navel is protruding outwards. So you'll want to watch. You can do push-ups against the wall and try the other core exercises that we're going to go through in a little while. All right, so just to recap, in terms of prevention, you'll want to create a strong, deep core in terms of the transverse abdominis before, ideally, or during the pregnancy. You want to avoid that rectus and oblique work during pregnancy, and I've also included 12 weeks postpartum. Ideally, it's like years postpartum because there's still, well, relaxin is still in the bloodstream, you know, up to 12 weeks postpartum, so there's still that ligament laxity, and there's still a risk at getting the diastasis in the postpartum period. So definitely 12 weeks postpartum, and then ideally, none of my postnatal clients are crunching. And proper rest from supine, so ensuring that they're rolling over onto their side and pushing up with the hands, not using the rectus abdominis or momentum to come up from that lying down position. And the last thing that you want to watch for is overstretching the rectus abdominis in that third trimester. So lying over the ball and stretching and overstretching. Even in cat camel, we typically like to avoid the arching part into the third trimester because you can sort of overstretch the rectus abdominis. So that's something to look for as well in terms of prevention. Pelvic floor. I talked to a lot of pelvic floor physiotherapists here in Ottawa where I am, and I would suggest that you definitely connect with a pelvic floor physiotherapist. I'm going to give you some sort of general outlines as to some pelvic floor exercises to incorporate into your program. However, if there's things like leaking or pain, or if the leaking isn't improving with a few Kegels, with a few pelvic floor exercises for a few weeks, you definitely want to refer out to a pelvic floor physiotherapist. Check it out, see who you've got around you, and if you do have somebody close by, I would definitely recommend. I think it's great, especially for a pregnant woman, to be able to get checked by a pelvic floor physiotherapist just to make sure that everything is functioning well and ready for childbirth. And even in the postpartum period as well, it's great to be able to have somebody that you can refer to. So, I'm going to give you some basic outlines, but generally beyond my scope in terms of, beyond that. So there's four types of Kegels that I like to incorporate. I might mix them up and mix and match and do all four, or just do a handful depending on, where people are at. And if people are not sure if they're doing a Kegel properly, I usually have them start lying down. It's easiest to do the Kegels lying down on the floor than it is to do them seated or standing. So from a lying down position, I'll have them just sort of place their hands on their lower abdomen, where the abdomen kind of connects to the hips, kind of in the grooves of the hips, and have them try a Kegel. And they should feel that inguinal ligament sort of lifting up. There should be a little bump there. And it's important when you're doing the pelvic floor exercises not to engage the glutes and not to engage the abs. It is just the muscles of the pelvic floor. So you shouldn't be squeezing the glutes, squeezing the abs, or contorting the face, okay? And it's wonderful because the thing is, you can be doing these anywhere. Like, you're probably doing them now, and nobody even knows. It's the beauty about doing the pelvic floor exercises. So that's why we sort of prescribe them on a daily basis. It's important to keep those muscles strong. And just like any other muscle, during pregnancy, there's a lot of strain that gets put on the pelvic floor, a lot of pressure. So we need to keep these muscles strong and helping with bouncing back after baby as well. So the elevators, these are engaging the pelvic floor at various levels. So it's lift, lift up, lift, as many floors up as you can get, distinct floors. And instead of just letting the pelvic floor kind of crash, you're releasing, releasing, releasing at distinct levels coming down. That's the elevator. You get as many floors up, maybe not as many down. It's a little more challenging coming down. The max contractions, you're squeezing the pelvic floor muscles as hard as you can without engaging the glutes or the abs. It's just the muscles of the pelvic floor, and you can use visualization like, if we're sitting on a bean and trying to lift the bean up the canal. The max contractions, 5 seconds at maximal effort and then releasing. The endurance, this is 15 to 90 seconds. And when I tell a lot of moms that a good pelvic floor activation is 90 seconds long, I get eyes this big because many women have a difficult time holding it for 15 to 20 seconds. So starting with as long as they can and then increasing their repetitions, just the 20% activation, 15 seconds, and working their way up to 90 seconds. Quick contractions. Contract, release as quick as you can. I'm sure you're all trying these now as we're going through, kind of fun. So I'll typically say, 10 sets of each of them, maybe all at once, maybe spread out through the day, 1 to 4 times daily. So that's a great plan for the pelvic floor. And here we go. Talking about the lower body, exercises to keep in mind, squats, split squats, lunges, if they're stable, because they need to have the balance and stability for someone who's, very stable. A dynamic bridge hip extension is a good exercise for the glutes. So where you're dropping on the ball, head and shoulders on the ball, lowering the hips and lifting, using the glutes to come back up. This is not considered contraindicated because we're not holding a supine position. It's dynamic, so that one's okay. The clamshells, the side leg extensions, the ball wall hip abduction is a great one. I have a couple of these that I'm going to show you in just a sec. And then some great upper body exercises, the snow angels, which I'm going to show you, any of those scapular stabilization type exercises. Rows are great, seated or standing, using the adjustable cable column or using the seated row machine or using a band even. The back extension from a quadruped position is great. Push-ups, again, if they're stable, you maybe want to do them against the wall for now. And, you know, pregnancy is not really a time to be making these massive gains, to be training for a race, or to be, you know, doing a CrossFit competition. Mind you, we do see it. But it's a time for us to be able to maintain our strength, stay strong throughout our pregnancy, you know, avoid those discomforts. Ensure that you're ready for essentially the biggest workout of your life, which is labor and delivery. Being able to be strong enough to go through that event and to be able to recover quickly. So, you know, these are, or at least my personal goal should be through pregnancy is to be strong and maintain and stay fit and, you know, of course get all the benefits that we sort of went through earlier and not really sort of risk. You know, there aren't a lot of studies. There have been a few studies done on mostly Olympians, Olympic athletes who have gone through pregnancies, and they have done some studies on, you know, maximal intensity type exercise, but there aren't a lot for us to say, yeah, maximal intensity exercise is safe. You can run a marathon. You can do this. You want to keep these everything sort of safe and effective. Some great core exercises, the draw-ins. From a seated and quadruped position, I've got videos of this, the five-level draw, and I'm going to show you the wall ball press march, which I love. I'm going to show you as well. I have videos of all of those. Essentially, you're going to omit all of those crunching type movements, omit those prone movements unless you've got that full support, so no bulging at the umbilicus. Okay, so here we go. We're going to start with some videos. The first one I have from you is my beautiful husband, John. He's going through a wall snow angel. So essentially what he's doing is depressing the shoulder blades. So he's depressing the scapula down, applying some pressure at the back of the hands. As he raises the arms up, he's ensuring that the shoulder blades stay depressed. So he's pulling the shoulder blades down as he raises the arms. So he's got those scapular stabilizers, those muscles in and around the shoulder blades that are sort of grabbing the shoulder blades and pulling them down to the hips, ensuring they stay depressed. As you raise the arms up, we don't want the shoulders to rise because that means that the upper traps are getting engaged and the low and mid traps are being disengaged. So that scapular depression is key, and you should feel this in and around the shoulder blades, maybe the rear delt, nothing in through the upper neck and upper trap, and we shouldn't see movement, upward movement of the shoulder blades. Okay, so that's a great one for scapular stabilization. Then I've got this cool ball wall hip abduction with lateral shuffle. Essentially, the ball is positioned right between the shoulder blades, and I'm squeezing the ball, okay, with the back of the hand. I'm doing a slight retraction of the shoulder blade. The hips are neutral. The shoulders are square. You're not twisting at the end range, and you're taking as many steps as you can. So maybe one, two, or three steps to one side, and then coming back and going over to the other side, which is missing in this video. It just has the one side there. So you're working on those scapular stabilizers, rear delts, and maintaining that neutral pelvis position in the shuffle. So you're getting a little bit of the lower body in that one as well. This is an excellent exercise, the ball wall hip abduction that we give to many of our clients who are weak in the gluteus medius, and we typically see this in pregnancy as well. You're looking to stand nice and tall, so John has his shoulders, hips, ankles all aligned nicely, okay, and I'm going to go back there. Everything is aligned nicely, and he's basically he has the ball centered, okay, at the knee centered on the ball, and he's pushing the ball into the wall, maintaining a slight bend in the standing knee. The shoulders are square, the hips are square, and he has his fingers on his glute knee, the gluteus medius, is actively engaged. As he pushes the knee into the ball, you're holding that push. So maybe you do 10, 15, or 20 seconds. Because of the angle, it's kind of hard to see here, but the foot is directly under the hip. And in this exercise, in a lot of glute med exercises, it's very easy to compensate with the TFL, the side of the hip, the TFL, the tensor fasciae lata, into the IT band. So you don't want to feel this directly in the side of the hip. It's posterior. It's kind of like that back pocket, maybe up sort of angle to the side a little bit. So that glute med, it's almost like a burning sensation when you're working it. Very effective exercise. I encourage you all to try it. If you don't have a ball, you can just put your knee on the side of a couch or even into the wall. You just have to tuck that inside arm in a little bit to line everything up nicely. Excellent exercise for the hip stabilizers and the glute med, something that we need very much. The dynamic 45-degree glide, John is using this. He's using the gliding disc, but you can use soft feet, okay, on a wood floor, or you can even use a paper plate. So he's working on stabilizing the hip and doing that 45 backwards extension. New mom can hold on to something if she needs a little bit of extra support. There's no movement in this knee here. The hips are very, very stable. So you're going to get that stabilizing work on that standing glute max and glute med, and you're going to be feeling the extension on the working leg in through the glute as well. So you're working to keep the hips very stable and working through that glute med on the stabilization part. This is a five-level draw-in. This is a great exercise. I encourage you all to kind of do this with me as I sort of walk through it. It's a little bit complex. Essentially, what you're going to be doing is inhaling to start. You exhale and draw the navel in five times. Then you inhale and release five times, or as many times as you can. So inhale to start. On the draw-in, the navel moves in towards the low spine. Notice my back is I'm sitting against a ball to ensure that there is no movement into the lumbar spine. This is very still. I'm just working. This is after the very latter stages of my second pregnancy. You're just working to draw the navel in and engage that transverse abdominis. So taking a deep inhalation to start, exhaling, drawing in, and releasing. So the controlled release is very challenging. Exhale, draw the navel in, feel like the two sides of the hip bones are coming inwards together, smashing together and inwards. And this is helping to engage the transverse abdominis, okay, compressing the abdominal cavity. So drawing in, and then releasing with control. Now, do you remember those elevator Kegels that I talked about earlier? With your clients who have mastered the draw-in and out, the five-level draw-in, it's a complex exercise, and we usually say draw-in on the exhalation. It tends to work well with that breath. You can add an elevator Kegel in conjunction to the exercise. So oftentimes getting the pelvic floor engaged with the transverse abdominis will increase your core activation, and you'll typically feel it a little bit more. So when you're exhaling and drawing in, you'll Kegel and do an elevator up, 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 and then release the elevator down on the inhalation. So it's exhale, elevator up, 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 and you guys are like probably trying this going, I don't get it, takes a little bit of practice. Kind of like me asking you to drive with your eyes closed. It takes a little bit of work, but play around with it. Difficult in terms of coordination, but excellent in terms of connecting with the core. So that's the five-level draw-in. This is an awesome exercise. I love this exercise. It's a static press and march. My husband, John, he was the creative between the two of us. He sort of came up with this exercise and some cool variations of it. He has his hands on the stability ball, and I love this for pregnant women because it's a great core exercise that can be done from a standing position, and it's great for people in general to be able to engage their core from a standing position. Oftentimes we work our core lying down, but it's awesome to be able to connect from a standing position because that's typically when we need the majority of our stability and support. So John has his hands on the exercise ball. Alternatively, the hands can be just flat against the wall. There is a slight protraction in through the shoulder blades. The ribs are being pulled in slightly, and he's got a slight posterior pelvic tilt. He's taking the arch out of his low back, tilting the pelvis forward, so he's got a rib tuck and a hip tuck pushing into the ball, and he is marching, alternating march, one leg at a time, without sinking or shifting in the hips. This requires a lot of transition zone activation, and this is important to be able to stabilize the pelvis and the torso in a neutral spine. So again, hands against the wall, pushing into the wall, marching, engaging the transverse abdominis, drawing the navel in, imagining the two sides of the hip, of the two hip bones smashing together at the front, feeling the transverse engage, marching slowly, alternating sides without letting the hips move or shift. And the, so using the core to be able to cement the torso and the pelvis is a very effective way. A lot of studies have shown that the best way to engage your transverse abdominis is by setting it and moving the limbs, moving the arms or the legs. And that's why we see things like the dying bug and those exercises that are really awesome at engaging the TVA. So love this exercise. Usually we'll start, if people tend to engage their upper trap, we'll usually probably start with just placing the hands flat against the wall, pushing into the wall slightly, keeping the arms straight, back straight, feet very close together to have that stability. Cool exercise there. The draw-ins from an all-fours position is great. If you do find that someone is, has a difficult time with the push-ups and the plank, kind of putting, with the pressure and the bulging, this might not be the best one, but it's fairly unloaded because they're not in a full push-up position. They're just on all fours. So I'm exhaling, drawing the navel in, inhaling and releasing. The back stays perfectly straight, and the posture is nicely aligned, head, neck, back, one straight line. So exhaling, on the exhalation, drawing in, maybe add a pelvic floor contraction, squeezing the pelvic floor on the exhale, and then releasing on the inhale. So that's the draw in from the quadruped. If that's tough, we can do this from a seated position. Exhaling, drawing in, inhaling, and release. It's kind of hard to see, but exhaling, pulling in, inhaling, release. And once they've mastered that, you can incorporate the Kegel in conjunction with it. Just quickly touching on cardiovascular guidelines. With the Canadian guidelines, we're saying stay within 12 to 14 on the RPE scale, which is the rate of perceived exertion. All right, we can also use the TOC test, which you all know of. So that's where you want to be at in terms of intensity. At one point, we were saying, you probably all heard it, stay below 140 beats per minute. That recommendation is actually now obsolete, and it has been obsolete for a number of years. We're not saying stay below 140 beats, stay below 140 beats a minute. And for those of you who have gone through your pregnancy, you probably know that your heart rate is already elevated at rest, and this is not a real accurate guideline in terms of intensity. There was a recent study that studied a lot of physicians and what they were recommending. A lot of physicians are still saying stay below 140 beats per minute. This was a U.S. study, even though that recommendation is obsolete. You don't have to say that. You can say 12 to 14 on the RPE scale or TOC test. Of course, you'll want to obtain your caregiver's approval. And essentially, we're saying if you've done activities before pregnancy, as long as you're not contraindicated, you can safely continue. So you can run during your pregnancy if you ran before pregnancy. I wouldn't start like a learn to 5K during your pregnancy. But if it's something, if you're a runner, then absolutely go for it. So just want to monitor your intensity and encourage our new moms to listen to their bodies. You may need to reduce the intensity as the pregnancy progresses. Things are going to feel really crappy after week 32, maybe even sooner than that. So you're just looking for those, maintaining at that point, just staying healthy and feeling good and not going too crazy. Omitting beginning a stretcher program after week 28 is considered to be a good thing. So if a mom has been completely sedentary throughout her entire pregnancy and she comes to you at week 29 and says, yeah, I'm ready to go, I would say, let's hold off till after baby. So active living initiatives like walking. And again, watching for overheating, dehydration, presyncope, which is that faintness, dizziness kind of feelings, pain, vaginal bleeding, and painful contractions. All right. So let me get out of here. Thank you so much. I'm going to open things up for questions. So 1, 2, 3, go. No questions? Okay, maybe I'll have Jason come on. Just to talk about CECs, and if you guys have any questions, then I can go through at that point.
Sure. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, thanks so much, Sarah, for such a great webinar today. Just to remind everyone, Sarah will be coming on again April 17th. She mentioned it during her presentation, but you can see her for her second part about postnatal exercise at 2 p.m. on April 17th. So as Sarah said, my name is Jason Gould, and I work for the Education Department at Camfor Pro. I just wanted to start off by thanking everyone for coming in today. I hope you learned a lot of useful information that you can bring to your next prenatal client. So I just want to let you know how you can earn CECs for watching the webinar today. So by next Tuesday, that's April 1st, there will be a quiz available for you to complete. It's at the price of $25 plus tax. And you can access the quiz through your Camfor Pro Interactive account. That's at camforprointeractive.com. So in order to actually earn the CECs, you have to complete the quiz and submit it and have a passing grade of 80% in order to actually earn those CECs, okay? If you're worried about remembering all the great content Sarah talked about today, don't worry. By next Friday, April 4th, you'll be able to watch the webinar again at no cost through camforpro.com. There is a link posted in the chat, so you can just follow that link and it will bring you to the webinar next Friday. If you do have any trouble accessing the quiz or the webinar, feel free to call our office and our customer service team will be glad to help you out. So I'm not sure if there's any questions available for Sarah.
Okay. Sorry, go ahead. Are you done, Jason? Sorry,
yep.
I didn't cut you off there.
No, definitely. Go ahead.
Okay, thanks, Jason. I'm just I'm seeing a bunch of questions pop up here. So,
perfect.
The first one here is, what if a person feels comfortable going prone or supine after the 16-week time frame? Again, as a fitness professional, it's not something that I would recommend. The majority of all of my clients avoid the supine position after week 16. Just again to be safe and you know, during pregnancy it's something that it's really important to be able to follow these guidelines. And I know that I sort of during both my pregnancies slept on my back, and I do believe I sort of woke up dizzy at some point. I think the body has the ability to sort of tell us when something's going wrong, but as a fitness professional it's not something that I would incorporate into my exercise program. So that's just me personally. After the week, yeah, I hope that answers your question, Stacey. Thank you. So Rebecca here, how far into the pregnancy does diastasis usually show up? So I've seen people that have had diastasis as early as 7 or 8 weeks into the pregnancy, and then we definitely see it in the latter stages of pregnancy as well. So I would be sort of checking it throughout, maybe every 4 to 6 weeks, just to ensure that you're sort of staying on top of it, recording and ensuring that it doesn't change or get any bigger, you know, as the pregnancy progresses. Chances are it will, but you're just sort of monitoring it. Give it a good, you know, 6 to 8 weeks before even checking it in the postpartum period. So allow the muscles their time to sort of come back together and allow that recovery. So try not to go too crazy in the checking process in that immediate postpartum period. And so, Stacey, you mentioned to not check the groove no more than every 4 to 6 weeks. Is that only when pregnant? Yes. No, sorry, it is not only when pregnant. Even in my new moms, even in people who have come to me with diastasis 5, 10 years postpartum, I'm still not doing the diastasis check every week. It's usually every 4 to 6 weeks. With a diastasis correction, it's very slow in terms of correction. So we don't want to continue to put strain on the rectus abdominis. So I'm still waiting every 4 to 6 weeks, but typically not seeing a huge change in that short amount of time. Anyway, I'm talking like it's a 1 year sort of recovery cycle here. What are some specific exercises? Oh gosh, you'll have to come to my postnatal. Sorry, I won't be able to go through it all here. Actually, a lot of the specific exercises to correct diastasis are the ones that I covered in this prenatal lecture. Some of them are very appropriate to that. Exercises that are not going to put strain on the rectus abdominis, but are definitely going to focus on the transverse abdominis. Sorry, I can't go into more detail there. Can diastasis occur without pregnancy? Example, men? Yes, absolutely. We see it in obese individuals. We see it in individuals who have gained weight quickly, Okay, so a lot of strain. We also see in individuals who have like a weakened connective tissue, if their core isn't really strong, and they go and do crazy things like, you know, surfing or something that put a lot of strain on the musculature. I do have a couple of clients who have had diastasis who have never gone through a pregnancy, so yes, it can happen. Kimberly, starting to exercise in the second trimester is fine if the client hasn't exercised in the first. She did exercise through pregnancy. Yes. So starting exercise in the second trimester is fine, absolutely, especially because the first trimester feels so awful. You know, you're getting that surge of progesterone and you're getting a lot of nausea and fatigue. Those of you who've gone through a pregnancy are probably like, yeah, you could fall asleep anywhere, like standing up, you're so tired. So yeah, second trimester is a great time to start an exercise program. It's usually a time where the second trimester is your honeymoon phase, where things feel amazing and awesome. It's just after week 28, so going into your third trimester. So if you're starting your third trimester and are in your third trimester, it's probably not a good time to start a structured exercise plan. So just like active living initiatives, they say, like walking and some gentle things. But yeah, second trimester is perfect. I think that was what your question was. At what point would you suggest your client seek out a health care provider for diastasis recti right away? If you have somebody like a physiotherapist that you know works specifically with clients with diastasis recti, I would definitely refer them right away. If you feel comfortable in changing their movements, ensuring that they're omitting the crunches and the twisting motions, and there's a lot of yoga and Pilates moves are really at risk here, like the Pilates 100 and the roll down, and even like triangle where it's a forceful twist. Those are movements that are contraindicative. So if you're comfortable omitting those movements, focusing on the core, come join me on the 17th when I talk about a little more about diastasis correction. You'll have a few more tools to work with, and you might feel comfortable sort of helping them. But if you're not 100% comfortable, then, yeah, absolutely refer out. Work with physio who's worked in that area. Or seek somebody out. If you also just Google diastasis, you can spend hours just kind of finding some very relevant information, a lot of stuff that I sort of shared with you here. What was the maximum height to raise your hands in a waltz? No, Angel. That's a great question, Stacey. Typically, I usually start off with 45 degrees, so not very high. When my clients are going through this exercise, I am palpating their upper traps. So my hand is on their upper traps. Maybe I'm also feeling in the subscap and those scapular stabilizers underneath. But most importantly, they are going as high as they can without engaging the upper traps, no higher than 90 degrees, because after that point, the upper traps are going to kick in, and it's a lot more difficult, unless you've got the bent arms doing that. So that wall gap raise exercise. But 45 degrees is a great start. Hand on the upper trap. Ensure that the upper trap is not firing. It can just keep the emphasis in through those mid-back muscles. The maximum height, I would say, would be 90 degrees or less even. It's not really about height. It's more about the quality of the exercise. So how high you can go without engaging the upper trap and keeping those mid-back muscles engage, those scapular stabilizers engage. Those are some awesome questions. Anything else that you guys are thinking of? Okay. So I have my email at the beginning. It's basically sarah@sarahzahab.ca. And if I've missed anything here, definitely I know that that Jason or Melissa will pass it on to me, and I'll be sure to answer your questions. I wanted to thank you very much for joining us. Thank you so much to Cancer Pro and Jason and Melissa for hosting, and I hope to see some of you or hear from some of you on the 17th. And awesome. Thank you.